Down the stairs or up the stairs, which I think is pretty good considering I am jet lagging. A couple of things about how I present. I tend to flap around and walk hither and thither. So if you can't hear me, raise your hands and wave them around. And I flap papers as well. The title here, Considering the Research to Ethics in Online Research, that's going to come towards the end. What I thought that I would do is I would take a look at what I think is are some of the crucial differences between previous communication revolutions and what's happening right now with social media, because ultimately I think that's what we're interested in this room, is sort of, oh my God, what is happening? Is the apocalypse nigh? Do we see the horsemen a-coming? So first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to speak. It is ironic, yes, that I've flown over from the royal wedding. Lack of hysteria. I have to say, there's very little hysteria in the UK about the royal wedding. Here, which is throbbing with royal wedding hysteria. I didn't have to bring any tat for my parents, my family, or anybody. They've already got it. So, thank you all very much for welcoming me into your royal wedding arms. Now, this is a forum that explores the practicalities of communicating research, communicating academic work. And the discussions that have taken place, both in publishing houses and also at conferences like this around the world, recognize that digital collaboration and dissemination are now part of the next stage of research. So, we know it's inevitable. The academics have been behind it from the start. We've always been at the forefront of new technologies, particularly if they're communication technologies, because these technologies support the function and the purpose of research, which hopefully is to spread knowledge in order to develop new understandings of the world around us. Now, the internet, of course, founded within a research institution, was built specifically for this task. But network technologies that emerged in the late 1960s, and you know, this is the internet via DARPA, have themselves undergone a profound evolution from high-cost, high-end, barrier-high computing, enormous sort of things that took up rooms this size, into social media, into something this big, that has now allowed the web to articulate and be articulated into a sort of actualization stance. Its most important primary function is and always has been a low barrier, easy access, universal human-to-human communication tool. But the technology is no longer under our control. These are the horsemen over the ridge over there. The ivory tower no longer has the control, much like authoritarian regimes around the world no longer have the control over the information as it's disseminated. This raises concerns for the future, not only of practicing research, but also its communication. So, for example, what effects will the open publishing practices that academics are beginning to adopt have on the peer review process for the traditionally closed academic state, and of course, how it is that you make your cash. There is currently a consultation in the House of Commons in the UK debating exactly this. All of the written evidence has been put up on the website. I highly recommend it. It's some really interesting analyses from people around the UK. The publications are at publications.parliament.uk, and the oral presentation is happening on the 4th of May, where we start to try and pick apart what it is that digital media means for the traditional peer review estate. The social in social media, which are the tools and the technologies that have captured the attentions of 600 million Facebook users around the world, wouldn't have been possible. The social element wouldn't have been possible if it hadn't gone beyond the wires, but of course also the walls of academic institutions. Crudely, it's these people, this public, that provides the commercial bedrock upon which new and ever more social technologies can be developed that ensure that the connections, that the content and the communities that emerge will continue to encourage the rich and fertile electronic ground that feeds their coffers and, of course, creates a place of value for researchers. So I say let the public in and let them eat digital cake. But with that opening treatise, as you can see, this is my political perspective when it comes to publishing. I'm now going to begin looking forward by looking back, by identifying as I said before, exactly what it is about these new social media technologies, about this popular medium, what it does that is unique to from previous communication technologies that we believe are revolutions, particularly within the academic and the scientific community. I will close with a few words of caution, as is my wont, as with the development process for Web 2.0 tools that publisher Tim O'Reilly described as iterate and iterate often, failure is, of course, the best learning experience for people who wish to move forward. So, I love this quote from Dewar in 2000. Each defining technology represents an important breakthrough. I'll let you read it because I hate it when people read off PowerPoint presentation slides. I really do, and I'm sure you all have literacy. I'm sure you do. You better. but I think crucial here, the important, the key phrase here is the defining technology. And of course, in our time, this is the web and social media. So what are these unique elements that I mentioned? Unfortunately, because I operate on a Mac, this was a really beautiful picture of a printing press. You just have to work with me, okay? Imagine it. It didn't transfer to the PC. We do still have barriers between technologies. The printing press, as you can see here, revolutionized access to knowledge. Ultimately, that was the key, that was the crucial element in the printing press. It changed the conditions through which information was collected, stored, retrieved, criticized, discovered, and promoted. It democratized knowledge. Right? It's a generic acceptance. It democratized knowledge by allowing access to information to all. So, for example, priests and scientists were no longer the gatekeepers of information. Their gospel truths, their interpretations of these things were no longer single, and nor were they infallible. Excuse me. So, and furthermore, the printing press bridged the gap between town and gown, allowing individuals the opportunity to publicize science and their scientific outcomes. Now, McLuhan argues that in addition to these democratic principles, the printing press also generated an ideological understanding of ourselves. I'm a social psychologist. I love this kind of stuff. Suddenly, we recognize that this notion of public and of self-awareness came out of this, as Eisenstein says. It allowed for the cumulative advance of knowledge. We were able to print something and say, wow, that's what we thought 5 years ago, and we've advanced this much. Whoa. We've changed, man. We've totally changed. And of course, they didn't quite say it in those ways, but you can imagine. It allowed us to view the past from a fixed distance. These human evolutions did arguably usher in the Enlightenment and the scientific revolution. And despite later industry and government regulations to cope with their absence of control, Pandora's Box version 1.0 was already opened. However, it was a very slow process. The web and social media has been levied with the same expectations as, you know, ushering global revolutions for knowledge. But notably, there are two very important differences between the printing press and the web. The printing press was very, very expensive. What the web does now is it offers everybody a printing press in the comfort of their own home or office. This means ultimately that information seekers, however, are deluged with the tsunami of information, this information overload that we keep hearing people talk about. Nobody's actually done any documentation on whether or not we are experiencing information overload. I find that a fascinating phenomenon. How will we curb that? That's a totally different talk, and I can talk to you each about that individually. But increasingly, people are relying upon heuristics, whether it's technological heuristics or psychological heuristics, to sift through all of this information. And I'll expand on this in a minute. Second, the speed, as I say here, the speed with which printed material is disseminated was far slower than today's hyperlinked, hyperconnected world. But we've also seen a technology that tackled this issue. And if you use your imaginations, this is a picture of a telegraph. Really nice picture of a telegraph as well. I can show it to you afterwards. It's on a blue background. It's very brassy. Now, the telegraph was invented in the mid-1700s, and by the time that the telephone arrived, it had crisscrossed the world, connecting all continents with instantaneous access to one another. It undoubtedly revolutionized the temporality of information, much like the web. It transformed commerce, it transformed crime, and it introduced information overload. It also allowed people to collaborate across distances, bringing about, as a 1958 edition of Scientific American described, an instantaneous highway of thought between the old and the new worlds. Yet, although it connected people around the globe professionally and socially, and it helped to speed up the dissemination of information, it lacked one of the most important concepts of social media. Indeed, also the printing press, which was the archive. And not just the archive of information, right, which is ultimately what it is that you're bringing to the table, but the archive of connection. And I think this is the thing that most people are struggling with. Social media's unique contribution to this landscape is that it combines the best of both the printing press and the telegraph, the content, the speed, the connectivity, and it adds the true democratization of publication, the archive of all of the content produced, and of course, the archive of connection. And it's these three elements of social media that social media developers exploit when they're generating their applications, whether it's blogs for publishing content and creating feedback mechanisms within communities that can also be distributed through RSS feeds, or whether it's network notation tools for disproximate, cross-disciplinary collaboration, which is awesome for scientists, of course, or social networks for crowdsourcing materials for self-promotion or for information sharing. I mean, there's a lot in this new landscape that has emerged because of these tools. And for academics, it means this. For researchers like me, it means this. Key area in the top quote is it allows you to create your own peer-to-peer environment to support and expand your research. And then in the bottom one, it allows people to gather and to respond to feedback than their peers, which is pretty fantastic. But before I conclude and say hurrah for the web, I am critical of the web. I'm critical of social media. I accept that it's awesome, but I also accept that it has its problems. There are two concerns that I have with social media for scientific communication. And after all, scientific communication is not just part of the funding process, and it's fascinating to see how this has been integrated into NSF grants, into ESRC and various research body grants in the UK and around the world. But it's also something that happens de facto when people like me put drafts of papers or open up their content via Science Commons online. My research examines how people are influenced online. That's the sort of crux of what it was that I did when I was working within academe. And increasingly, I've worked on questions through my external research and also through my public engagement discussions that seek to unpick those social heuristics that content consumers use to identify information that influences them. And what I found is that social media developers, whether consciously or not, you know, consciously, of course, as I say, it's a great feedback. If you start getting more money, more users, you just keep doing the same thing. They develop tools that deliver exactly what the consumer demands, i.e. content that is relevant. Google does it. It's great. But we've got an entire dark web that lives underneath the top layer of Google. So much emphasis has been put upon creating SEO optimization. That's a bit redundant, but SEO. That we lose somehow all of the other information that's underneath. Now, obviously, it's great commercially, but in terms of generating the critical content consumer, it falls significantly short of empirical scientific outcome. And of course, this is where the contradiction in what I brought up before comes in, the credibility of peer review, and thus you'll be happy to hear the validity of your particular industry. So keep going with that. But when it comes to scientific communication, in the past, the dissemination of knowledge was maintained behind the firewall of peer review. However, this process has now opened up, and it continues to do so through initiatives like Science Commons, as I mentioned before, Creative Commons, under which most of my research is published, and Digital Science, which comes out of the Nature Network and Macmillan, which seeks to encourage primarily physical scientists to promote and distribute their raw data. The once closed system of generating a public understanding of science has broken down. Unfortunately, what tends to happen through social media is that like gathers towards like. Hello, Echo. We've been talking about the echo chamber in terms of political participation since 2004. Lada Adamek explored exactly this for a fascinating research paper looking at voting patterns and communication in blogging systems and hyperlinks between blogging systems in the 2004 elections. Now, that was then. I would argue that this is actually increasing thanks to an uptake of things like Facebook and Twitter. I collect around a posse of people who think like I do, who share information that supports what I think, and who voice views or practices that are similar to my own. This means that the potential for opening up research, for publishing research online, actually has a contradictory effect, which is a real shame, an enormous shame. Because while there's more knowledge that's out there, the public's view narrows through their social networks, through their Twitter feeds, and through their RSS. I think that this ultimately makes them less critical of research findings, less willing to sift through the enormous archives that you and other people put out there, and more reliant upon those heuristics of credibility, the technological and psychological heuristics that I briefly mentioned before, like, for example, the number of followers that an individual has. Yes, I have 16,000 followers. I can type things out there. People will believe me. It's freaky. I'm like, I'm sorry. I don't know anything about, you know, the latest economic developments. I'm a social psychologist. This adds an interesting layer, though. This specific element adds an interesting layer to the dialogue about research communication via social media that goes beyond the sort of the general discussions about Joe or Jane, no one publishing content that goes outside of the peer-reviewed process. To a social media validated individual publishing something that they know economics very little about, but still being held up as an authority on the subject. More than anything else in the future of how you consider research to publish openly via social media, I think it's very important to bear in mind that the audience may not be as critical as it needs to be. I'm sure this is something that you think about anyway, but I think increasingly as people are using Facebook to find their news, to find their content, to find their information. This is something that's becoming more and more important. The information is out there, and it opens up profound possibilities for future knowledge and for innovation. But whether it's within traditional academic institutions, whether it's through initiatives run by publishers, or whether it's through initiatives that are run through commercial organizations, consumer education really needs to be brought up, and criticism really needs to be brought to the fore when it comes to content that's published through social media. My second concern is a question, and this goes back to what the title was of this, is what can be considered ethical research. Obviously, this is something that you need to consider when you decide what it is that you publish. The web and digital tech, I've done so much thinking on this at the minute. I'm working with the Oxford Internet Institute at the moment to really pick apart what it means to be ethical online. There are researchers who've been thinking about ethical guidelines and you know, a sort of pan-disciplinary guidelines about what it is to do ethical research online. The web and digital technologies offer huge possibilities for current and future generations of research. We are in a golden age. It's pretty awesome. I have absolute freedom, pretty much, to explore, define, collect, analyze, and distribute knowledge. It's pretty much an open platform, right? It's pretty amazing. But our only limits at the moment are our technological expertise. I cannot program, and so I have to bring in people who can help me to scrape data. I have to bring in people who will provide me with that skill set, and also the size of our processors. But if we begin to factor the human on the other side of the machine, we start to limit our opportunities. There are, as yet, very few human subjects guidelines for this medium. U.S. institutions' understandings of the issues are fractured and conflicted. European ethics boards are practically non-existent and often irrelevant. And the rest of the world regulations, which is, of course, pertinent because this is, of course, an international medium, conflict with the ontologies of everybody else. So what we've got is we've got chaos, right? Nobody really knows what's ethical. And into this void are people who are, frankly, taking advantage. I'm trying not to, but you know what? We're not doing it in a way that's necessarily what we perceive to be harmful. Stanley Milgram didn't actually realize just how effective his experiments would be on conformity when he asked his participants to give increasingly intense to so-called fatal electric shocks to people or recordings in the next room. This resulted in harm to his participants. Philip Zimbardo at Stanford didn't anticipate that his famous prison experiment would be called off after 3 days because of the abuses that the participants who were randomly assigned to be prison guards were meting out to the people who were randomly assigned to be prisoners. Again, similar psychological harm to their participants. Scientists who conduct research online have got to have a responsibility to the people behind the screens. And we have to be aware of the phenomenally fascinating questions that are being asked. Virtual shocks can have the same effect as physical ones, just because they're psychological effects. This is obviously not physical effects, unless you're hooked up to strange machines. But that, again, is another talk. Just because they're conducted over the internet doesn't actually make them any less effective. I'm a social psychologist. I'm scraping so much data, behavioral data, off the web that, well, we'll get into that in a second. It's absolutely incredible. But to ignore this is to potentially cause harm to participants, to their online relationships, and ultimately to the communities that it is that we're studying. It's not enough to disguise the identity of research participant by using an online handle. Community members' reputations are wrapped up in their online handles, and exploring a virtual persona can be as exposing and as devastating as using an individual's real name. Beyond the research that actively engages people behind the screen, data can be collected about them without their knowledge. It's fabulous. Search terms, social network connections, transcripts of chats, of forum posts, of at replies on Twitter, link trails, surfing patterns, all of these things create incredibly well-rounded pictures of individuals online. This is, frankly, the most exciting resource, because everything online is a behavior. We don't get that in the field. We really don't get that kind of thing. This is not experimentally induced action. And increasingly, well, not just increasingly, but psychologically, the barrier between the online and the offline self, the public and the private performance, is often forgotten by the participant, which is evidenced by the occasionally embarrassing indiscretions that are sent around via email or links on Facebook. But in addition to this, there are also the assets that not just they put online, but their friends put online, whether it's the videos, the tags, the photos, the blog posts, the comments. All of these things create a 360-degree picture of an individual. And in addition, the tendency for individuals to become to be more open and honest online, to activate more weak ties, and to treat search engines like Google as oracles or confessionals means that the data is profoundly rich for understanding human behaviors and intentions. But the apparent wealth offered by these digital research tools that kids going through PhDs at the minute are being trained in and are being encouraged to use ultimately obfuscates the potential harm that may come from them. And for example, from the false positives that are based on data-driven analysis. My greatest concern with web technologies that researchers will use in the future and that the results of which you will publish is that they will create an abundance of profoundly rich binary code that will effectively depersonalize the human beings behind the computers. So, soapbox, I'm off. To conclude, the web and social media have created an enormously fertile ground for research possibilities and the communication of science. This medium offers an extraordinary extension of the affordances of previous great communication revolutions, but by recognizing that the archive, the connectivity, the speed of distribution will deliver new opportunities for collaboration, for publication. We also have to consider the best ways to empower the consumer in a critical way, and also how to promote research that protects the individuals on the other sides of the screen. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alex, for a very thought-provoking talk. Questions?
Thank you. My name is Angela Cochran. I'm from the American Society of Civil Engineers. We're finding that we're having to argue more and more with adults about not using Wikipedia as an actual academic resource or reference in academic papers. Do you think that we're going to have to change that? I mean, is it becoming so much of kind of the social norm that we're going to have to accept that Wikipedia is actually a viable source of information?
That is such an interesting question, because I probably every year I hear a kind of flip-flop between academic institutions saying, it's terrible, we mustn't, and hey, it's okay. And these are the same people who will then flip-flop back and forth. One thing that I do know, and I can't respond to that specifically by saying, yes, we will have to change, or no, we must stand steadfast, is that the Wikimedia Foundation, who are the umbrella organization, you may have seen Jimmy Wales's face on Wikipedia asking for money for the Wikimedia Foundation over Christmas. They are conducting some very thoughtful research at the minute, specifically targeting academics, looking to see why they don't participate in Wikipedia. What the outcome of that, I hope, will be an understanding for what it is that we consider and we recognize to be true knowledge. And also, I think that will help. What they will do is they will seek to develop tools and to develop communities that will encourage more academic participation in that space. Unfortunately, that kind of goes against the ethos of Wikipedia, in that it's supposed to be a community-generated, collaborative information resource. When I was teaching in the sort of early 2000s, I suppose it was mid-2000s, because it was after Wikipedia had started to become a real sort of thing. I regularly just said, no, you can't use Wikipedia. No, you can't use Wikipedia. No, you can't use Wikipedia, because you don't know at any one time what who's saying, and you know, people don't go into the discussion thing. What I think may evolve is a recognition of this fluidity of information, that while people may reference Wikipedia as, you know, this says X, Y, and Z, we'll have an adaptation to recognize that this person said it, it was on this date, it responded to this correction that somebody else made. So in some ways, recognizing that it is a fluid piece of information. It's about sort of relinquishing that notion that we are the true holders of knowledge and of information, and that there are other experts out there who can contribute this knowledge. And I think that may be some way that we will start to view it as a more valid platform or a more valid reference source. I hope that answers the question.
Just down there on the left.
We were just having a little side conversation about that, and one of the interesting things about Wikipedia is you want to be in the references. So, I mean, I have three teenagers, they all go to Wikipedia, and I always tell them, go there and go down to the bottom and find out when someone says something, where did they get that from? And that's the place that you want to go look. And yeah. There was even at the Charleston conference, I think it was OUP, saying that they had written into some of the contracts with their editors and authors that they were to maintain certain topics in Wikipedia and get OUP references in there.
That's very interesting. And I think that again, goes back to my point of people just saying, well, thank you very much, this confirms my knowledge, as opposed to going down and seeking. Historically, I can't actually remember, it feels such a long time ago, but I can't remember if I was ever allowed to reference the Encyclopedia Britannica. You know, it was always used as a kind of, right, this is a starting point. You don't know an answer, you don't know what something means, we'll get up and go to the bookshelf and have a look at it, and it was a starting point. So if we consider that and help to frame that, I mean, it's a profoundly useful resource. I go there to start a lot of my work, and then I kind of go, okay, brilliant, I've got an overview, I've got the kind of bullet points, and now I'm going to dig a bit deeper. The danger comes when people stop there and don't go to those resources and those references, I think. Danger.
I think it was about a year ago that there was a law professor, and I think it was here in Washington, who told his class, his law class, that Justice Roberts was going to be, that he had just heard that Justice Roberts was going to be stepping down from the Supreme Court. by the time the class was over, it was already being reported around Washington. And so that from the class, it had gone out through Twitter, and feeds had been picked up on it, and people had been already starting to report this as fact. What kind of liability and what kind of ethical issues apply in that kind of situation when somebody does something to test but then actually has ramifications that could potentially embarrass or present a false impression of what the situation really is?
One of the columns that I wrote, the Untangling the Web that was referenced before is part of a series of columns that I write for the Observer and Guardian newspaper. And a few months ago, I was looking at news gathering. Not journalism, but news gathering, because journalism is a different thing. And one of the things that I focused on was during, it was a conflict, somebody was killed, it was bad, it happened in a fort, it was a US incident, and a so-called eyewitness was tweeting, and that suddenly made, you know, CNN, it made everybody panicked, and it turned out that the individual who was a so-called eyewitness was actually in Michigan just having a bit of a laugh. The liability for that individual, I don't actually think the liability lies with the individual. I think the liability lies with the people who say, I'm going to tweet it on, or I'm going to report it as news without doing fact-checking, without looking a little bit deeper. There's always going to be people who want to put disinformation out there. There always has been, whether it's been pamphlets or whatever. They're doing it for a particular agenda. They're having a laugh. Hackers like to see how far they can push the boundaries. I mean, these are all just examples. I think the liability lies with the so-called credible organizations that then perpetuate that story, and then you see it reported as fact without really truly looking a bit deeper. Now, having said that, if that was a year ago, and the incident that I'm thinking about I think was 2 years ago, there has been a greater understanding and recognition by journalists and news gatherers for being a little bit more critical about tweets. You know, they're starting to say, whoa, it's a useful resource, but we need to start querying that information a little bit more, as opposed to having this hyper, oh my goodness, we need to break this story. We saw this, you know, wherever. Andy Carvin at NPR is doing a great job with, you know, a lot of the tweets and a lot of the stuff that's come out of, you know, out of North Africa over the past 6 months almost. But that, it helps that he's essentially done it off his own back. He's already part of a credible news media source, and he's done a really beautiful job of making sure that the resources are valid. He's also done it in a very transparent way. So I hope that answers your question, and that, yes, we are hopefully moving towards a place where we're starting to see a little bit more criticism of the new media content.
There's a question in the middle here, Richard.
I hope so. I really hope so.
I'm Daniel Culp from the American Physical Society. Following up a little on this line, in propagating information, as you said, the ethical responsibility is on the professionals as to how they interpret this. However, there's a strong understanding that the public itself doesn't have that sort of criticality of thinking. And so from an academic point of view, the sort of the open web or the social web is a soapbox sometimes for those academics who are off the beaten path, you know, those that are trying to sell perpetual motion machines, things that contradict the second law of thermodynamics, etc.
You're so limited.
I know, I'm narrowly focused in my thought. But, you know, I think that's one of the reasons why academics sometimes are afraid of getting onto the web, because there's also the sense that a minority can really shut up a majority by being hypercritical or pushing these non-standard ideas, and the public tends to glom on to it. Is there anything that can be done about that from, you know, from the publishing professional perspective or from the academic perspective?
One thing that publishers have already is a credibility. Right. They already do have an offline credibility. Brands, we thought that brands wouldn't, you know, we thought brands would sort of disappear with the web, with Web 1. And Google came on, and Amazon came on, and suddenly everybody was like, wow, you know, we've got new brands. Facebook, new brands, they will undermine everything. But frankly, you know, the Guardian, the BBC, the NYT, the FT, you know, all of these organizations have existing credibility that when they go to this space, they have a bit more say, they have a bit more reach. When it comes to the thermodynamics and the people who are promoting that content, these people have always promoted that content. If you aren't participating in the conversation and if you aren't respecting the public enough, and yes, I did say that we do need to create an environment in which we help to create a critical consumer. If we're not participating in that space, then we're saying to the consumer, well, we don't respect you. We don't think you can be critical. Well, they can very well be critical. You simply have to provide that information and see what it is and help them to understand and to recognize when a law of thermodynamics is being broken or those types of things, by providing the counter evidence with all of the evidence in the same way that we do as academics. We say, well, here is the evidence. There is, surprisingly, I just recently, one of the columns that I did was on religion. And one of the questions that I asked was, have there been more religions? Have there been more cults? Has there been more alternative thinking out there since the web has come about? And all of the people that I interviewed, the researchers for whom this is their primary focus, have said that no, there aren't more cults. And no, there isn't more alternative thinking. It's just that it's a bit more exposed. It's just that it's out there more. And it's the same thing with this knowledge. And if you don't participate in that conversation, then the noise, as it were, is going to become considered valid. We all know the metamorphic nature of knowledge. Wikipedia is a great example. You know, what is considered true, the ontologies of information. We all know that this is constantly being shifted through evidence. So we need to provide that evidence and create evidence-based information consumption to help to counteract the guys who are promoting the sugar pills.
I have a question for you, Alex, while the everybody else is thinking about those things. How do you feel peer review will evolve on the web? Will there ever come a time when there's some kind of crowdsourcing of the results of research is just put up there, people comment on it, and there is no peer review as we know it today?
I think that's such an interesting question. Oh, and this parliamentary review, this parliamentary inquiry is so fascinating because there have been so many different stakeholders who've thrown their tuppence in. 2 cents. I'm translating back, it's a bit confusing. As well as the fact that the oral presentation is happening next week. I'm fascinated to see what will come out of that. I think that from the relatively static peer review process that we have now, which is academic X writes paper, sends to publisher, publisher distributes to well-respected, credible authorities in the field, it comes back, it's published, thank you very much, that's it, that's done. Occasionally you get, you know, a feedback, a response, and then nothing is brought up again on the topic until somebody says, well, actually, I've created counter evidence or I have supportive evidence. I think what we'll see is a longer tail. We'll see peer review, initiatives like digital science are promoting the notion of putting the content up there, Science Commons as well, putting the content up there ahead of time so that it can be iterated, so that the crowd, whether credible or incredible, as it were, has the opportunity to feed back that content. That will then be brought in according to relevance, according to, you know, validity, as it were, into the paper. It will then be published, sent out for traditional peer review for, you know, the highly credible authority people, figures. And then it will come back, it will be published, and then that's not the end anymore. And I think that once it's published, we will then have a much more dynamic response that will then continue online as opposed to on dead trees. So we'll see an evolution in which the peer review process continues and continues and continues so that X dead tree version is not the final word. And I hope that that's what will evolve.
Any more questions from the floor? Michael.
Alex, I just want to pick you up on what you just said, because you as an author, If you think of the consequences of what you've just said, that means you're going to have an ongoing debate that may not ever end about every paper that you ever publish. Do you see that as a desirable outcome?
Yeah, I do. I mean, people will get bored. I still have people commenting on things that I wrote 4 years ago, but then I've also got things that I've written more recently that everybody's like, well, that's fine. Or, you know, somebody who will come along later on and say, well, I've just discovered X. And I think that's part of the engagement process. I think that's part of saying, well, things have moved on from 4 years ago, and this is what we're thinking about now. Because it's not a static entity anymore. So I hope so. I hope so, and certainly that's what I do with my own stuff.
I'm afraid, based on some of the surveys that we've conducted, you may be in a minority, I think. Most academics would like to say what they say what they've said, and move on to their next piece of work. And the trouble with, and there are many of our publishers do actually do sorts of post-publication mm-hmm. yep. commentary, and BMJ is a very good example
yes.
of that. But these things are moderated, and they are brought to a close eventually. I think the big fear that many fellow academics have is that being stuck in some kind of unmoderated seminar
flame
never seems to come to an end, and inevitably, as we know, after 3 or 4 days, any discussion on the web inevitably starts mentioning Hitler or whatever. So
or cats.
Exactly. So it does start to get starts to get out of control. So I think it's interesting because if on the one hand the readers want it, but the authors don't feel so keen about it. I mean, that dichotomy, how do you think that's going to play out?
I wonder to what extent that will shift as the creators of knowledge, or so-called knowledge, as the creators of this content themselves shift. Yes, it's nice to say this is the final word on the subject, but that's quite egotistical. There's a lot of hubris associated with that. More and more, I think, well, I'm hoping that people are recognizing that. And so I do wonder, it would be interesting to see a longitudinal analysis of the survey results to see how things do shift over time.
Any more questions? Back in the middle.
Thank you, Alex. It's interesting talking about the extension of the peer review process, meaning you write a paper, there's some open discussion, and then it goes through a more traditional. There's been some experiments, I think, in the field of mathematics about actual sort of crowdsourcing the writing of the paper. Mm. I don't know, where someone would come up with a certain theme and an unknown question in mathematics, put it out on the web, people would contribute from all around the world, just random people, and then at some point, when they reach a solution, I guess either the original author or someone decides which were the key points that were brought in, they become the authors of the paper and it gets submitted. Mm. Do you imagine that expanding something? I mean, that means you're communicating and collaborating with people. You have no idea who they are or what their backgrounds are.
It's a really, really interesting experiment, isn't it? The LA Times tried to do that a few years ago with their articles, and it failed. Oh man, it failed really miserably. And The Guardian has, to some extent, tried to do that in terms of curating a lot of the live content that's come out of particularly the Egyptian conflict. That's kind of how it views, it's beginning to view its reporting is as a curator, not necessarily it is still a content creator. And also Penguin did a really interesting experiment called 1 Million Penguins in 2004, it must be now, where it was a wiki novel. And I've actually done a wiki game where I've had people from around the world contribute code and ideas and stories. So I think that's an interesting experiment. I think it's very difficult to wrangle, but I think it's an interesting area of potential collaboration. It makes sense. I mean, there's people who play in bands that haven't actually seen one another, and they play online, and with a few sort of glitches about time lag. you just have to be very regulated. So they are interesting collaborative experiments, but I think underneath your question, which is a question that goes through a lot of the discussions in environments like this, and goes back to the Wikipedia question, it goes back to the who's commenting, who is contributing. That is a very difficult and challenging one. because as they say on the internet, nobody knows you're a dog, you could blah, blah, blah. There are tells. There are great tells online for offline identity. One of the drums that I bang a lot is that your only currency online is your reputation, and you develop and you create those reputations by participating. And so, a primary author may say, well, I recognize that you are valid because I've seen you comment on this and that and the other forum, and so therefore your contribution will have plus one or plus six validity in this, in this mathematical paper. Or whatever paper it is that's being collaborated on. And I think if this type of thing becomes more common, it's a lot of work. it's a lot of work to wrangle that kind of thing. But if this type of things become more common, I think that those heuristics will become more blatant. They'll become more obvious. That we'll be able to see how people identify who is valid in this particular field and what it is that people draw on to identify somebody who has credibility or whose voice is worth saying.
It's like having an online publication record.
Yeah.
Absolutely,
absolutely. So things like, even you see this in communities as well. You see this in things like Reddit or Dig or any of these other communities. Even Yahoo Answers tried to do it, where they kind of exploited the notion of reputation. They tried to quantify. Amazon does it, but it's gamed. It's quantifying a reputation of an individual. There are less crude ways of doing that.
Kind of related to that, and also another side conversation we were having on this side, is that one of the things that I'm not hearing here is the idea that community never ever meant everyone. You live in a community, everybody in the world doesn't live there. You have book clubs, everybody in the world isn't a member of that. And so two things is, one, there's nothing to say that as a publisher, especially in a specific academic discipline, who knows who your members are, for example, or things like the Oregon Initiative, you can't validate people, even if they choose to use pseudonyms, that they have credentials,
yeah.
And that their comments, perhaps you only take comments from validated individuals, and everybody else in the world can watch if they want to, or you even close it down. There are so many options here. It isn't just open the floodgates or close them.
Oh, and The Economist did this recently, where they said, we've chosen 100 economic leaders to have a debate. You can watch if you want. You can't participate, but you can watch. You can throw questions in, but you can't actually come up with the answers. I think there's another interesting thing that you've just reminded me of, which is when people ask me, right, wow, I want to go viral, or wow, I need to be in social media, I think it's really important to recognize that not all social media is relevant. Don't flood it. Choose what it is. Choose the particular affordances of Twitter, of Facebook, of a blog, of Wikipedia, of whatever it is. Don't just kind of go, whoosh, there you go, I'm on everything, because it's a lot of work to maintain these things. I don't use Facebook anymore because I spend so much time populating Twitter with inanity, which I do. I apologize for anybody who's just followed me. You will see. it's just what I do. But that's, so there are different affordances to different types of media that you can use that will help to create those communities so that you can identify the validity and the credibility of those individuals, if that is, in fact, what it is that you want to do.
Any last questions from the floor? I had one last one for you, Alex. I was curious about your idea that people gather to people who think like they do. And if you think about the new article economy, where people can actually choose to be alerted to very specific articles rather than whole issues or tables of contents of issues, does that mean that academic research is going to become too focused, and academics themselves are going to stop looking at things that perhaps don't agree with them?
I feel like you've just sort of given me a great in to my latest project. Thank you.
<You're welcome.
laughs> So glad you asked that. possibly. One of the other drums that I bang is and I've only sort of alluded to it here, is the danger of the tools for reducing exposure to contrary information, and in many ways to serendipity, to those wonderful, not quite random encounters that enhance, help you think a different way, you know, do those different types that expose you to different things that are related, that are relevant, and all of these types of things. So potentially, I no longer, unless it's on a Saturday and I happen to have time, or a Sunday, I don't just browse the paper anymore. I will only get technology feeds, and I will only get them from three or four sources. Everything else, I rely upon my Twitter feed. I rely upon that content to come to me, and I have specifically chosen those people because they're my friends, or as I say in here, you know, they validate. I do think that there is a danger, very, 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 very much a danger of that within the academic community. If I can just get, you know, X, Y, and Z, yes, I can become an expert in that specific field. But I had a great conversation the other day with a friend of mine who's a neuroscientist. He doesn't describe himself as a neurobiologist. He doesn't describe himself in any way except as a neuroscientist. I'm trying to pinpoint him exactly what it is that he does in neuro. But anyway, that's a different point. He was talking about papers that he's about to publish that deal with specific questions. And they have to do with identity, and they have to do with anonymity. And he was arguing that he thinks he's found the neuronal basis for in-group, out-group. And I said, well, have you thought about this? Have you thought about this? Have you thought about this? These theories from the perspective of social science, of social psychology. And he hadn't. And I think, but this is something that we are constantly battling with anyway as scientists, because we are so focused on our particular disciplines. It's something that we need to, in some ways, be active about creating. And I'm going to go back to the Guardian thing that I said before about this notion of curation. One really interesting thing that The Guardian has chosen to do, and other newspapers as well, but The Guardian in particular has done it very well, is, and there are more tools that are trying to do this as well, is create a platform that says, okay, well, this is our line. You read The Guardian because you are a teacher, you're liberal, you wear Birkenstocks, and you eat mung beans, right? This is our people. Right, this is our line. Right? You've chosen this paper because of this. But here are some other points of view that come. And we're going to create a page in which we've got feeds to CNN, to Fox, to The Telegraph, to Al Jazeera, to the same story. We've got feeds from the ground, from Twitter, from this and that and the other, from images from all over the place. We're going to create a sort of microcosmos of this particular topic. And all of this information will be here that's related, that comes from different perspectives. And I think that's something that can be increasingly explored from a publisher's point of view when it comes to specific disciplines, specific topics. There's different ways that you can break this apart, rather than looking, in the newspaper world's case, at demographics, at looking at the different kinds of information sources that come in to help exactly that problem.
Thank you. And Alex, thank you so much for a fascinating talk.